Thank you, Paul. Thank you all for coming. Can't see any of you with the lights. Slides? Oh, over there, all right. I thought maybe they'd be behind me. So I've been writing about Apple at Daring Fireball for a little over 7 years, started in 2002. And somebody said to me the other day, just sort of out of the blue, and it really kind of rings true, that I picked a good time to start writing about Apple professionally. Because they've had a pretty good 7 year run during that stretch. I don't take any credit for it, but. And just, you know, to put it in historical context, so when I got started writing Daring Fireball in 2002, Mac OS X had only been out for about 18 months, and most Mac users were still on Mac OS 9. The iPod was only out for 1 year. It was currently a Mac-only, FireWire-only, 5 gigabyte, $400 music player. And people like us, we loved it. People who come to Macworld already saw it as, you know, a big hit. It changed the way we listen to music. But in the real world out there, it was like a non-event. It was actually something people hadn't even heard of yet. Nowhere near where it is today. So given how successful Apple's been since 2002, I think it's unsurprising that if you look at everything I've written about them, then you say, what is positive, what is negative, that most of it is, yes, overwhelmingly positive. And I would say that's actually a good thing. It shows that I got it right, because if they've done so well, most of what you've written about them should be pretty good. But there's a certain type of person who, when they decide to criticize my work or they disagree with one particular thing, as Paul said, it's always fine. Sometimes I'm wrong. And we can always, you know, have people who disagree. But there's a certain type of person who, when they do disagree with me, they bring out the F word. And I know there's probably a lot of kids here, because I know I have a lot of young children fans. But I'll just say it. I hate it, the F word. Fanboy, right? Oh. Like, I couldn't even put it on a slide because it's just such an awful word. But the reason I hate it, it's not because I feel defensive about it, it's because it's like a totally unfair, useless word, because it has no part in any kind of reasoned argument. In fact, the whole point of a word like that, or calling someone an apologist or whatever you have, is that's the type of word you use to cut off reasoned debate. It's a way of saying, your opinion on this doesn't even count. And so what can you say in response? I mean, you can act like a kindergartner and just be like, no, I'm not. So in general, I just try to let my writing speak for itself. And I'm pretty proud of my record. And if I'm wrong, I make a correction and move on. But every once in a while, I can't resist it. And somebody will write, and they'll get under my skin. And the way I always try to write back to them when they do something like that, by calling me a fanboy or an apologist, or of course you love blah, 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 because you love everything Apple does. I'll write back and say, I'm intrigued by your thoughtful criticism and insight. Can you tell me which specific parts of this article is incorrect? I would love to post a correction and give you credit for it. And when you're reasoned like that to someone who's sort of lashing out at you, it often just makes it even worse. And if they do bother to write back again, they'll say something along the lines of, oh God, if you love Apple so much, why don't you marry them? That's actually a good question. I was thinking about this on the flight out. Here in the United States, there's a legal concept called corporate personhood. And the idea, in a nut, by which I mean I cribbed the following couple of sentences from Wikipedia, is that certain of the rights afforded under the law to persons should also be afforded to corporations. One longstanding and I think uncontroversial instance of this is the right to enter a legally binding contract. Corporations have the exact same rights to enter binding contracts as do people. So recently, though, a few weeks ago, our Supreme Court issued a ruling in a case where they concluded that corporations also have the right to freedom of speech under the First Amendment. Now, this decision was controversial, and it doesn't matter which side of it you're on, but it became highly publicized. Like, President Obama even criticized it directly, brought it up right in their face in his State of the Union. And in protest of the decision, there's a corporation in Maryland that's declared that they want to run for Congress as a corporation. But let's go with this idea, expanding to corporations rights previously held only by people. Marriage is a right currently held only by people. So I think you see where I'm going with this. So I'm looking forward to today. Maybe, you know, a couple of Macworlds from now, I'll be up here and I'll be able to be introduced as John Gruber, Mr. Apple Incorporated. I like that. All right, so let's get down to business. When Paul Kent invited me here to speak, he suggested this premise of the Gruber 10, a top 10 list of informed but opinionated issues that I see facing Apple today. And what appealed to me most about this is that it's easy to come up with the 10 problems. And there's no real need for me to also propose solutions. I just have to come up with the problems. I will note one more thing before we get started, that they're not necessarily in any particular order other than what felt right to me, except for the first one, which is the big one. And that's Steve Jobs. So knowing, just to take a step back before we get to the current situation, let's just say, go back 25 years to 1985, and Steve Jobs is 1 year out from leading the team that shipped the initial Macintosh. And at that point, he got forced out of Apple. Everybody knows that this happened. This is not like a footnote in history. This is like a major turning point in the whole mythology around Apple, that, you know, the guy who found it in a garage and led them to this sensational start got forced out, stabbed in the back, was away for a decade, then came back and led them back to, like, previously unseen success. It's, you know, it's a fantastic story. You couldn't make it up for a movie. But we just sort of accept it as fact. It's the way that, like, things that have happened in history, no matter how absurd, once they sort of settle in, you stop being amazed by it. So, like, just consider, like, prohibition in the United States. Like, less than 100 years ago, they outlawed booze. Like, what is it? Think about that now. Like, if somebody came up and decided for their campaign for next year in politics, hey, let's outlaw booze. Like, but somehow it happened. They fired Steve Jobs. Right? I mean, that is crazy. So for all the hand-wringing and worrying over the past few years about what happens to Apple when Steve is no longer there, in 1985, they had him, he just delivered a hit, and they fired him. It's inconceivable. So how did it happen? I think he was blindsided because he knew, probably more than anybody, what we all know. He's the greatest product guy in the history of this industry. And firing him then, before, after, or at any time, would be the stupidest thing Apple could possibly do. His error was in failing to realize that companies that are poorly structured and poorly run have the unfortunate tendency to actually do the stupidest thing that they could possibly do. It wasn't enough that he could lead great teams to create great products. So what I think he did in the aftermath of that was to sit back and figure out how a large company should be structured. The whole reason that Jobs convinced John Sculley to join Apple as CEO of Apple in the early 80s was that at the time, Jobs bought into the notion that there was a need to have like a separation between the product guys who make the computers, which is where Jobs saw himself as leading that, and then there's the business guys who run the company. And I think it's clear that after he got axed, that he figured out that the right way for things is that there is no separation. The products are the company. And if he was going to do things right, he needed to run the company himself. So what does he do now? What does he create? He's not in Xcode writing Objective-C. He's not in Photoshop designing pixels for the UI elements. He's not Johnny Ive in the hardware lab milling out hardware and aluminum and making prototypes of physical devices. But I do think there's one product that Jobs designed himself, personally, and that's Apple, the company, since he came back. What are the hallmarks of a great Steve Jobs product? I would say things like simplicity, clarity, obviousness, elegance. The direct in favor of the abstract. Well, those same adjectives that I think describe Apple products, or at least all the good ones, also describe Apple today as a whole. But his current singular and central role at Apple poses an obvious paradox, and it's one that people really don't like to talk about, and it's uncomfortable, and it's this. He's irreplaceable. There's no doubt about that. But on the other hand, he will eventually no longer be there. There is no doubt about that. It's a certainty. Everybody's going to be gone someday. So the only comparison point I can really think of is Walt Disney. So in the 20s, Walt Disney wanted to make the world's best animated short films. and he was making them for the existing studios at the time, and of course, they screwed him. So he decided, all right, I gotta make my own studio. And he got his brother, who had some actual business sense, and they made the Disney Brothers studio. And they made the world's greatest animated short films. The 30s rolled around, and he was already unsatisfied. He wanted to make animated features, which no one had even tried before, wasn't even known if it was gonna be possible, if it would work, would people even go to see them? Well, they pulled it off. They made Snow White, they made Pinocchio, they made Dumbo. They made these great movies, which don't just stand the test of time as great animated films. I think you can honestly argue that you go back to like 1939 when Snow White came out. It's hard to find another movie from 1939 that still stands up today that you can actually watch and say this is still a good movie by modern standards. But he still wasn't done. Next came TV, and at the time, most movie executives saw TV as a threat. It was something that was keeping people from going to the movie theaters. How do we go back to the way things were? Walt Disney was the complete opposite. He saw it as an opportunity, another thing that Disney, the company, could grow to dominate, and they did. They had amazing success on TV. As soon as that was done, he immediately moved on to theme parks. Why would you do that? I mean, it's one thing after another. Never satisfied with previous success, no matter how great. Always looking ahead to the next big thing. Sounds a lot like somebody else. But it's obviously a morbid comparison because we all know how Walt Disney left that company. He died. And after he was gone, the company struggled. It wasn't like you don't go back and think, wow, those Disney cartoons from the 70s were unbelievable. They weren't. So the pessimistic take on Apple is that while Apple is obviously and undisputably right now a well-organized company, the pessimistic take is that it's a well-organized company that is organized entirely around one irreplaceable guy, Steve Jobs, and that he's effectively a keystone. You remove him and the whole innovation engine just stops turning. The optimistic take, though, and I'm kind of coming around to it, is that perhaps Jobs has structured Apple similarly to the other company he created while he was on exile from Apple, Pixar. Pixar is a company that has created a system and a culture for amazing quality and creative innovation with no singular figure at the center of it all. And the system works year after year, and it's repeatable. So perhaps in his absence, Apple will work like that too. It's a question, and we won't know the answer until the time comes, of whether it's a cult of personality or a culture. Number two, AT&T. So AT&T is one of like 70 mobile carriers around the world that carries the iPhone. But let's face it, it's the most important one because it's the one here in Apple's biggest and most important market, the United States. In many places, including, I don't know if any of you who have iPhones have noticed, in places here like San Francisco, AT&T's service is not so good. And it surprises me. I live in Philadelphia, and overall, I mean, it's not good, and calls tend to get staticky and break out in weekday afternoons, but it's bearable. And then I come out here for this, or I come out here for WWDC, and it's literally absurd. It's almost comical how bad AT&T service is here. So a fundamental thing to understand about Apple is that they seek to control their fate, no matter what they have to do, to own any dependencies that they consider to be essential. So they clearly believe in the adage, if you want it done right, you have to do it yourself. I mean, Apple is the greatest example of that I can think of. That's why they got into retail. Everybody said, everybody who's gotten into retail has botched it. Gateway and Sony and all these other computer makers that got into retail, lots and lots of people predicted doom. Why did they get into retail? Because it wasn't being done right. Retail, Apple's computers were not being sold right in retail, so they did it themselves. In recent weeks, they've announced that the iPad's gonna ship with a brand new CPU chipset called the A4 that they've developed in-house. Why? Because they want it done right, so now they're doing it themselves. But there's one thing that's important to their current business that they can't and don't control, and that's the mobile carriers. So AT&T's performance over these last few years has only proven the point of why Apple seeks to control every aspect of its operations that it can. It's also like uncomfortable and unnatural to see this because Apple doesn't really do partnerships. Who else is a partner with Apple? You don't really see the Apple logo with other logos anymore. But there are these ads with Apple and AT&T's logos right next to each other. And so it leads to contradictions. And right before the iPod debuted, and if you think like to the last couple of weeks, like December and January, and this run-up to the iPad, if you go back a couple years, it was exactly the same with the iPhone, where there was this feverish speculation that everybody was saying, Apple's working on a phone. And everybody wanted to know what it was going to be, but nobody knew. And nobody was certain. And so I had like two contradictory notions at the time in that run-up to the iPhone. Literally right up to like 2 days before, I just had this idea that, of course Apple's going to do a phone, because all phones suck, and we know that Apple could do a good one, right? We know that they could do a good one. But on the other hand, I had this notion that, of course, they're never going to do a phone, because there's no possible way that Apple could bear to deal with and make the compromises necessary to work with any of these mobile carriers. So how do you square a contradiction like that? Obviously, the way you do it is you have to ignore one of them and just sort of plow right into the other one. And Apple decided to make a phone. But so now, 3 years into this thing with AT&T, and we've seen the results, there's a new contradiction like that. And we heard a lot of this in the analysis in the run-up to the iPad, when there was speculation over, well, who's going to be the phone carrier for the iPad? So on the one hand, you think, well, of course Apple's going to break the exclusivity with AT&T. It's like a Darth Vader, you have failed me for the last time situation. Like, you don't get to screw up that many times for that long and stay on Apple's good list. But on the other hand, there's the sense of, well, of course they're going to stick with AT&T because they've kind of got AT&T by the balls. Where the one and only thing that AT&T has that's a competitive advantage against Verizon, it's clearly not the network. It's the iPhone, right? They've got this one thing that Verizon can't have, or at least can't get on their own without working out a deal with Apple. So of course, Apple is going to be able to squeeze better deals out of AT&T than they could possibly get out of Verizon. Because Verizon isn't feeling heat. Verizon might want the iPhone, but they're not in pressure. Whereas AT&T is under pressure to keep this deal. So of course they're going to keep it. And that's the way that seems to have worked out. I mean, you never know, but the iPad is clearly going to debut AT&T only. So how is Apple going to get out of this mess? I think the answer is exactly what they've said. I think they're going to be patient for now and give AT&T more time to fix this network. One frequently misunderstood thing that I comment on occasionally that I think people have about Apple is that Apple's top executives seldom speak publicly. But when they do, you can almost always take what they say at face value. It's not spin. So, for example, and especially on these quarterly finance calls where there's legal repercussions to exactly what words you say, if they don't want to answer, they don't answer. If they do answer, you can believe it. And one of the analysts asked, well, what are you guys thinking about AT&T? You know what I mean? And Tim Cook, Apple COO, said more or less that Apple has reviewed AT&T's infrastructure plans for the future for fixing this where their service is poor, and that Apple is satisfied with their plans. So we'll see. The proof will be in the pudding, but I think as it stands today, AT&T's problems are draining Apple's brand equity. And I don't think Apple ever wants to be in a position where they need to apologize for a product or service, but that's where AT&T has left them. So number three, this is my favorite slide. Computers.
I've always wanted to have a slide that just said computers.
When I was a kid, my first memories of computers, like the TIs and the Apple IIs, and even like things like the Atari 800, the Commodore 64, you'd turn them on, and when you turn them on, they'd beep, and then a couple seconds later, you'd get this text interface with a command prompt, just a little square, and then you would type cryptic things, and that's how the computer, that's how you got started. Everybody knew that wasn't the future of computers. Everybody knew the future was going to be amazing, fantastic, it was going to be mind-blowing, it wasn't going to be this type, but, you know, it'll come here soon enough. But what exactly, like, did we think that was going to be? And I think we pretty much thought it was going to be this, right? It was going to be Hal. It was going to be the computer you talk to. You wake up and you say, computer, what's the weather like today? And then your computer would be like, hello, John. You might want to bring a jacket today, perhaps an umbrella. You have three new messages. And you know, that's not the way it worked out. What did we get? What was the next step? What was the future? It was this, right? It was the Macintosh. Far less cool, never led a mission to Jupiter, but it was real, and it never killed any astronauts.
So I guess today's equivalent of what, like, in the past, we, and the big word back then when I was a kid for the future of computers was AI. It was all gonna be artificial intelligence, and that was this idea. And of course, we think intelligence, we think we're intelligent, so we thought it'd be a computer like HAL that talked like we do. I think today when people think of the future, like the far future of computing, they think of Minority Report. They think of like some kind of goggles and you put it on, and instead of a display, you get like a virtual display that's projected, and so it's like having like a 78-inch display right in front of you, and you're doing all this stuff with your hands, and it's 3D, and you're moving stuff. What did we really get? We got the iPad. We got a little 10-inch piece of glass, but I think that that is to the future of computing today what the Macintosh was in 1984. So now that it exists alongside the Macintosh, though, the iPad, we find out not if Apple can walk and chew gum at the same time, but if Apple can chew two different pieces of gum at the same time. Apple has never had two computing platforms thrive at the same time. In the 80s, the Apple II started dying the day the Mac appeared. And it took a while, and like any kind of transition, for most of the 80s, it was the Apple II that fueled Apple's revenues, not the Mac. But clearly, I mean, once you've seen the Mac, you knew that the Apple II was not here for long. In the 90s, Apple introduced the Newton. The Newton had amazing new technology, but never caught on in the market, didn't have the sales. And at the same time, even worse, the Mac, which was still selling fine, was technically languishing. It was the worst time ever when the Newton was out, how the Mac fared competitively at a technical level to anything that it competed against. In the O's, or whatever we're calling the decade that just finished, Apple grew the iPod and the Mac at the same time. But the iPod and the Mac don't overlap at all. The iPod is technically a computer, but it's not a computer computer. So you don't have to choose between your iPod and your Mac for doing a certain task. You don't create keynote presentations on an iPod Nano, and you don't go jogging with a MacBook Pro clipped to your belt. And to a lesser extent, that's even true with the Mac and the iPhone. Even though the iPhone is a computer computer, you could do things like email, browse the web, watch video, same things you could do on the iPhone that you can do on your Mac, and so you kind of have to choose. But because of the profound difference in the size of the screen, this versus this, it's almost always a function of where you physically are. Where's your butt? Are you standing? Are you out? If you're near your computer, you're going to use your computer. If you're not near your computer, you're going to take your iPhone out of your pocket and use that. With the iPad, it's a whole different story. I mean, I hate to rub it in everybody's face, but I got to use it for a little bit. And it's really good. And I've used the browser a little bit more because the SDK, the second beta came out, and it has the mobile Safari and the iPad, and I've gotten to play around more with that. And I'm telling you, it's really, really good. I honestly believe that if you're sitting on a couch and your coffee table's right in front of you, and you've got a MacBook Pro and an iPad right there, and you're like, hey, I'm gonna read some stuff on the web, I think a lot of people are gonna choose the iPad over their MacBook Pro. It's really that good. For some of the same things that you do on a Mac. The next time I do a presentation after this one, I'm gonna have to make a decision. Am I gonna do my keynote deck on my Mac in Keynote, or am I gonna do it on my iPad in Keynote? I'm gonna have to choose between two Apple platforms. In and of itself, that the Apple now has two platforms that overlap in functionality is not a problem. The issue is that Apple's never pulled that off before, and so we don't know how that's gonna turn out. Next, number four, the App Store. I see two fundamental schools of criticism of the App Store. And I think the first school is that Apple is headed in the entirely wrong direction with the App Store, that they more or less need to turn around and go the other way. And by that, I mean the way that every single bit of third-party software that goes for the iPhone is funneled through the App Store with Apple's approval. And I don't think anybody who's reasonable or lives in the real world is endorsing the idea that Apple should scrap the App Store. Clearly, that's not going to happen. I think what this branch of criticism more or less wants is for Apple to do with the iPhone what Google has done with Android. When you go to the store and you buy an Android phone, you take it home, you take it out of the box, the only way to get third-party apps for it is to go through the marketplace, which is Google's App Store.
But you can go to the system settings and you go down and there's a checkbox and it says something along the lines of allow apps from sources other than marketplace. And you check that and it gives you a warning and says, you know, here's what that means. You click OK. And now at this point, you can install native Android apps that don't come through their official marketplace. And that's a great argument. And I think whatever the merits of that argument, and I think they are valid, my belief is that Apple is not going to do that. There's no way they're going to do it. And so I think from a practical perspective, the only practical way to criticize the App Store is the second school, which is not that they're headed in the wrong direction. It's that they're headed in the right direction, or at least a right direction. But they're a few degrees off course. And my concern about that is that so much of the criticism is that they're in the wrong direction. And I think Apple is convinced that they know they're in the right direction, that they just ignore all of the criticism because it's incompatible. There's absolutely no way that they're going to go the other way. And so that they're also ignoring the sort of course correction criticism. And by that, by what I mean by just a few degrees off course, the reason I think it's a problem is that even just a few degrees off course, if you're going really fast, and the App Store is clearly going really, really fast, it doesn't take long before you're lost, even just a few degrees off course. So what do I mean? Updates take way too long to ship. So somebody has an app, and if it takes 2 weeks for the first version to get through the approval process and get in the store, well, that's still a pain, but all right. But then when you issue bug fixes, and they take 2 weeks to get through, it's maddening. It's like going back to the days when software was shipped on floppy disks and CD drives, and you really, really, really had to go through this expensive, painful QA process to make sure that you had the least possible bugs in what you shipped, because how do you get the updates to people? People didn't even have the internet, so they didn't even know there was an update that they would have had to somehow get on a floppy disk if they knew about it. But the App Store has sort of taken us back to that sort of mindset where you can't ship fixes as they come in, and it's very, very frustrating. I think that rejections from the App Store should only be for very obvious, glaring reasons. So for example, the Google Voice thing, no way should that be rejected. The dictionary for, well, that was weird. The dictionary app that was rejected for the curse words. Never should have been rejected. Sorry about that. I think I got it. All right. Sorry about that. It should only be about quality control, not competition control. And I think that's clearly the line that they've crossed with some of these things that rubs people the wrong way. And I think in the long run is bad for Apple's business. The good news is, though, I think they're actually doing this. I almost didn't even include this as one of my issues, because in the last couple of weeks, especially since Christmas, anecdotal evidence from people I know and from readers who sent me email at Daring Fireball suggest that since Christmas, the turnaround time for approvals has improved dramatically. And in some cases, I even heard from a developer who said he submitted a bug fix and it was in the App Store the next day. So I think Apple has, I don't know how they're doing it, because it seems to me like the scale is still growing, but it seems like they're throwing more and more people at it, and it is getting better. But the bottom line is that the App Store puts Apple in uncharted territory. And by that I mean, on the one hand, iPhone OS is clearly like Mac and Windows, where it's got hundreds of thousands of software titles and tens of thousands, and probably soon 100,000 developers. But on the other hand, it's also a lot like console systems, like the Wii and the PlayStation and the Xbox, where all of the titles available for the platform are approved and licensed by the platform vendor. So there have been tightly controlled console platforms before, and there have been platforms with hundreds of thousands of apps and hundreds of thousands of developers, but there's never been a tightly controlled console system with hundreds of thousands of titles. So we don't know yet if this is sustainable. And if there's 150,000 apps in the App Store now, what's it going to be like in 2 years? And if it proves to be unsustainable, what's Apple going to do? Are they going to put their head in the sand and say, tough, or are they going to open it up? I don't know. Number five, security. Last year, there was a guy who wrote a thing on security on the Mac, and I don't know why, but it like turned on a light bulb for me, and I've been writing about some of this stuff for a long time, but here's what he wrote. This guy's name is Dennis Fisher, and he wrote, "Little, if anything, gets Mac users more exercised than the mention of their favorite machine's security problems. Despite the fact that security experts believe Macs to be much easier to exploit than Windows machines, Mac users simply trot out the old saw about there not being any virus attacks on Macs. Not only is that assertion demonstrably false, but it misses the point entirely. Virus attacks are not an indicator of the security of an operating system." And you read that at first, and probably a lot of you read it, and you think I'm going to make fun of the guy, and that it's some kind of straw man attack. But it occurred to me that there's a difference in semantics between the words security and safety, and that's the key. The guys who are obsessed with security are thinking about technical measures, and the real world analogy would be to like the quality of the locks on your doors and your windows at your house. Whereas safety is really about the likelihood that you're actually going to have a problem. And so a house that's not as secure, has flimsy locks, might well be perfectly safe because of where the house is located. So Microsoft, I think, has, in fact, implemented far more advanced security measures in Windows than Apple has in Mac OS X. But that's not surprising because Windows is the place that needs it. And it rings untrue, though, when the security expert guys complain about Mac OS X security. It rings untrue to Mac users, though, that Apple is somehow doing anything wrong, because the evidence clearly suggests that they're secure enough to keep us safe. But I'm becoming more and more concerned about one specific aspect of Apple's approach to security. And it's not the design of the system and arguments like, is it inherently a better designed operating system for security, whatever. I don't even care about that. But there's one thing that Apple, I think, is doing wrong, and it is with their response to publicly disclosed vulnerabilities in open source libraries, and it's the time it takes for them to patch them. So here's one specific example. In September, just this past September, there's a guy who found a problem in just about every single implementation out there of SSL. SSL is the secure sockets layer, so it's when you send your credit card to Amazon, that if it goes over SSL, then anybody who sees the network travel in the middle doesn't see credit card numbers, they see encrypted data that is economically unfeasible to decrypt. Well, this guy found a problem in a bunch of open source libraries, including the one that Apple uses for SSL, that allows a man-in-the-middle attack, which is exactly what it sounds like. A guy who can see the traffic can somehow get the keys to decrypt it. It happens. I mean, it's, you know, it happens with all sorts of open source libraries. So this guy found it in September. OpenSSL, which is the library Open used, they fixed it in November. Apple didn't ship a Mac OS X security update with that fix for 75 days. And this is for a vulnerability that the guy who found it, when he found it, he just published it. So anybody who's following and looking for, say, SSL vulnerabilities, it wasn't a secret. And it certainly wasn't a secret after OpenSSL published their fix for it, and you could actually look at the source code for what was different between the version where it's not fixed and where it is fixed. But it was 75 days before Apple shipped that to customers. And that's not an isolated instance. It happens over and over again where, yeah, Apple fixes this stuff, but they're always the last vendor to do so. And because it keeps happening, it leads me to conclude that they don't see it as a problem. I'd say that Apple ought to be taking the opposite attack and trying to be the first vendor to apply these patches for these open source things, because Apple's the company with the biggest target on its back. Because Microsoft doesn't use them. Microsoft's, everything they do is their own stuff. They're not in this open source community. Of the people who do use stuff like OpenSSL, Apple's the big target. So I think it would really serve Apple really well to get paranoid about fixing these issues for publicly disclosed vulnerabilities very fast. Number six, MobileMe. Why does MobileMe exist? Right? I mean, if you even find yourself asking that question, you might have a problem. I think of two answers. And the one answer is, I think, very good. And that issue is syncing.
And so it's, I'm out and about, and I take out my iPhone, and I put in an event, and I put it back in, and when I get home, because I use MobileMe, and it actually works, I look at iCal, and there's the event. And it's great. And it is, for the last, you know, year or so that I've been using it, I couldn't be happier with it. It's fantastic. But there's another side to MobileMe, which is the web apps. What's the point of them? So if you're at your Mac, you're going to use iCal, you're going to use Address Book, you're going to use Mail. You're not going to use the web apps for MobileMe. And if you're not at your Mac, isn't that when you're supposed to be using this? I get the feeling that the MobileMe web apps are sort of Apple's way, like where everybody out there is web apps, web apps, web apps, and Apple wasn't really in that game, and they kind of like had a feeling like that's what the kids are talking about. Maybe we ought to have some. And I think of like a traditional like lounge singer whose peak was in the 40s, and then Elvis comes out in the 50s, and then he grows in, like some lamb chop sideburns and starts playing guitar. It just doesn't seem right. And then there's another aspect of it, which is iDisk. How many people here use iDisk? How many people here are happy with iDisk? I see a couple hands. How many people use Dropbox? Yeah, Dropbox. How could this possibly happen? Dropbox is a couple of guys with a free service, and it absolutely kicks the crap out of iDisk, which is from Apple and has been around for like 10 years and is part of a $100 a year service. Should Apple buy Dropbox? I don't know, but they might, maybe they should. But at the very least, Dropbox has set a baseline for file sharing syncing between devices that iDisk clearly does not reach. And it's completely unacceptable that they charge $100 for it. Number seven, backups. So data loss. Data loss is a tragedy. It really is. And it's what makes it tragic is that, in theory, it's preventable. You can't keep a hard drive from failing, but you can definitely keep a backup of everything that's on the hard drive. Now, maybe it's a minor tragedy compared to tragedies of life and limb, but it's a tragedy nonetheless. And I think Apple is vulnerable to this compared to some of its competitors because its core products, the Mac, the iPhone, and now the iPad, use as their primary data store local storage. You lose your device, you've lost the data. Now, you can plug in your iPhone and your iPad via USB to your Mac or your PC and sync to iTunes, and you get a backup, and that's great. And I've used it. And then if you lose your iPhone or you break it or you buy a new one, you can plug it in and restore from that backup, and your data's back. But there's an awful lot of people out there. I mean, you've seen the numbers on how many iPhones they've sold. There's an awful lot of people out there who do not sync their iPhones. I've heard of people who don't even know that you can sync your iPhone to a computer. And it sounds funny if you know that you're supposed to, but it's actually kind of reasonable. And Google actually does have the other approach, where with an Android phone, which I think its advantages over the iPhone is that an Android phone is completely self-sufficient on its own. Even software updates are delivered over the air. You can download them over Wi-Fi, and the thing just reboots itself. If you never once connected to a computer, you're not necessarily missing out on anything. So Time Capsule is sort of the right idea of backups, where once you've got it configured, the backup just happens, and it does nice things too. Like instead of just snapshotting the last good known state of your hard drive, it keeps versions of everything. That's great. But Time Capsule is not really a solution for the type of people, which is a lot of people, who aren't even syncing their stuff via USB to iTunes. It's still fiddly, right? It's just not automatic enough. And so clearly, this stuff has to be ultimately, long-term, in the cloud. And I kind of hate calling it the cloud because, there's no such thing as a cloud. It's all data centers and cables and actual hard disks and computers, but it kind of works as an encapsulation of you don't have to worry about it, it just happens. And it puts them on poor footing, Apple on poor footing against Google, because if you buy into the whole Google lifestyle, where you're doing everything in Gmail, and you're using Google Calendar, and Google for your address book, your primary data store isn't local. Your primary data store for that information is in a Google-run data center, which probably is about as good a place for your data to be as anywhere in the world. So I'm skeptical about Apple's ability to offer invisible cloud-based backup for iPhone OS devices and maybe even eventually the Mac, because they've never really demonstrated any ability to do this sort of thing, cf the previous bit about iDisk. Next, Apple TV. So this is the one everybody loves to talk about. That's Apple's one dud, right? I actually like Apple TV. I've got an Apple TV. I like it. Fanboy. The problem with Apple TV, though, isn't the Apple TV itself, not the hardware, not the software. The problem is that it's fundamentally about one thing, watching Hollywood movies and TV shows via the iTunes Store. And I know that it has YouTube, and you can get podcasts, and you can sync your own stuff from other sources, from iTunes on your computer, over your home network to the Apple TV, and you do that. But fundamentally, the whole idea is that if you've bought it, you're probably thinking that you're going to be watching stuff from the iTunes Store. And there's a bunch of problems with that right now. The problem is that there's not enough of it, either the movies or the TV shows in the iTunes Store, and a lot of what is there isn't priced right. A whole part of the core product of this conception of watching TV shows and video from iTunes is out of Apple's control. It's controlled by movie studios and TV networks. And you sort of run into the same problem with it, like they have with AT&T, where they've ceded this control, they can't take it, and the experience suffers accordingly. In a nut, all of the old growth entertainment industry executives, the music, TV, movie guys, doesn't matter which one they're in, they all want the same thing. They want to go back to the way things were. You want to watch Cosby? You better be on your couch at 8 o'clock on Thursday, right? And then everybody gets to see the ads at the same time, and there's no TiVo, and you want some music? You're going to buy an $18 CD. Well, that's not going to happen. You can't put the digital genie back in the bottle. But that's their mindset, and there's no talking them out of it. So when the TV and movie executives look at the music industry, which is the one that's already been iTunesified, they don't look at it the way I think they should look at it, which is to say, wow, those guys were absolutely getting killed by bootleg downloads, and now Apple figured out a way to get paid for downloads. Instead, I think the movie and TV guys look at music and they say, Apple didn't help those music guys get things back to the way they were. And so what have we end up with? So with movies in the iTunes Store, there's a worse selection of movies in the iTunes Store than any like neighborhood video rental shop that I've ever seen. So Avatar comes out a couple months ago. Gets me thinking about James Cameron. And I love the movie True Lies. I don't know, I think it's funny. So I was like, hey, I'll rent True Lies. Guess what? Not there. And it's like, it was like a smash hit from like, I don't know, 1997. It's not that old, it's a big hit. Is there a movie store anywhere in the real world that doesn't have True Lies? True Lies, not there. All sorts of stuff is missing. And new releases are almost all on these like 2, 3, 4 week delays of where you can't rent them because they want to have this exclusive period where you have to buy them. And it's like, does anybody really fall for that? Where it's like a movie you know you kind of want to watch once, and it's like, oh, I can't rent it. Why don't I get it for $15? It doesn't work, but that's their mindset, and there's nothing Apple can do about it. It's on Apple's decision to say that new releases are purchased only for 2 weeks. It's the studios. And then with TV shows, it seems to me like the whole model is just broken. People don't want to pay $2 for every show they watch. And I'm not even sure that 99-cent pricing, which is rumored to maybe be coming as an experiment, I don't even think that solves the problem. HBO and Showtime and things like that aside, there's 60, 70 years of evidence that what people want with TV is free TV that is subsidized by advertising. And we'd rather complain about the commercials than pay to get something without the commercials. And I think that the lack of sensational success for $2 episodes from iTunes backs that up. So the best example, I think, of how screwed up the TV guys are is Hulu. How many people here enjoy the Hulu? Yeah, Hulu's, it's a great idea, and technically,
technically well done, and the video quality is great. You know, like you're used to YouTube, and you watch Hulu, and it's like really nice H.264, and the resolution is good. And so technically, it's a great thing. They really did a great thing. And it's got shows from NBC and Fox, and I guess other, you know, cable networks that are owned by those guys. But the guys who run it have this crazy, like, brick wall in their head, like firewall between TVs and computers. And Hulu is for computers. And a computer is something like this, right? Like my MacBook, or it's something on your desk. And it's something, and the reason they're okay with that is because you could never really watch their shows on those devices before. But a TV is the thing in your living room, and they don't want Hulu on that. They want you, if you're gonna watch there, to watch it through your cable provider or however else you normally get shows. So anybody like who shows up at Macworld and knows anything at all about computers, you all understand there is no difference anymore, right? A TV is just a display. Your computer has a display. So your Apple TV is a computer. If you buy a Boxy, it's just a computer. It's all just ones and zeros on a computer that connect to a cable to a display and light up pixels, right? It's just pixels and ones and zeros. It doesn't make a difference. But the Boxy guys, everybody knows Boxy. Boxy is sort of like a competitor to Apple TV. And they figured out a way. Their big difference is that they're just about getting video onto your TV. They don't have a thing. Unlike Apple TV, which is married to the iTunes store conceptually, Boxy is sort of agnostic about where you're getting your video. It's just throw video at Boxy and Boxy puts it on your TV. So they figured out a way to do it with Hulu. Well, the Hulu guys freaked out because Hulu is not for your TV. Oh, no, no, no. So, but this makes no sense, right? Because the thing that they should be worried about is the same thing that happened in the music guys. They should be worried about people bootlegging this stuff with no ads, with no payment to them whatsoever, right? Hulu is a service that they made and they put the ads on and people are watching it, right? People are watching a thing that they made. Isn't that like you make something, you want people to watch it. And yet they're freaked out because of where the display is in your room or in your house. So I don't see how Apple can get from where they are right now with TV and movies in the iTunes store. I can't see how they get from where they are to where they need to be to make it a hit when they're negotiating with people who are that stupid. Number 9, arch rivals. I think when a company reaches a certain level of size and success, like when you're really your company is a titan of industry, it tends to run out of direct rivalries because the company inherently, when it gets that big, takes on a unique shape and a unique perspective and dominates certain angles, and there's nobody else then left who does quite the same thing. So consider Microsoft. In Microsoft's heyday, when they were really, really go, growth, and were the hottest company in the world, they were really something to see and admire when you look at this industry, not from whether you cared for their software aesthetics or you liked their apps or liked their operating system or whatever, but just viewing it as sort of a sport, the competitive angle of the industry. And they were really something to see because they were relentless and they were fearless and they had rivals everywhere. They started out behind on everything. So the top word processor was WordPerfect. The top spreadsheet was Lotus 1-2-3. The best PC developer tools came from Borland. Microsoft set their sights to beat all those guys, and they did it. They even had rivals for operating systems. IBM, who at the time was still very much interested in the PC business, in a consumer sense, had OS 2, which was supposed to be that's the next thing after DOS. And Microsoft had Windows, and they killed them. They absolutely killed them. So a lot of those companies don't even exist anymore. IBM, still a big company, but Microsoft almost literally just knocked them out of the PC business. They're just a giant consulting company now. The last one they did it to was Netscape, and they got in trouble for that because of how badly they did it. And it almost reminds me of the scene from Raging Bull where Robert De Niro's character, Jake LaMotta, is fighting the up-and-coming kid, and his name's Pretty Boy De Niro. And he beats his face into hamburger, and when it's over, he just says, "Ain't pretty no more," right? And that's sort of what Microsoft did to Netscape. It was almost like unseemly
how ferociously they wanted to destroy that company, and did. They got in trouble for it because, you know, there'd been a couple of other rules. But since that time, the one and only new thing they've done, I just published a thing on my site a couple days ago that showed their from their most recent financial data, where's all their money come from? All their money comes from Windows and Office. The only thing they've done since the Netscape thing that's really had any kind of success at all that you can measure would be Xbox. And I don't think it's a coincidence that the Xbox is the one thing they're in with very direct, well-established, talented rivals, Nintendo and Sony. I think Microsoft's overall loss of relevance and seeming inability to innovate anymore corresponds directly to when they no longer had any serious rivals. Rivals help you focus. And I worry about Apple not having a rival. So who else is there? There's Google. So Google's a crafty competitor. They've got this thing they say, don't be evil. Everybody knows that. They're very famous for their slogan. I've always taken that as being a sort of, always, like right from the start, a sort of euphemism. What they mean by don't be evil is don't be Microsoft. And they can't quite come out and say that. And culturally, they really are a polar opposite from Microsoft. Microsoft is a management-heavy company, filled with middle managers. And there was something that Joe Wilcox published this week where he interviewed a bunch of people who've recently been laid off from Microsoft. And they talked about how when they joined the company in the 90s, there were seven guys, managers between them and Bill Gates. And when they got fired last year, or laid off, whatever you want to call it, it was up to 12, 13, one guy said 14 managers between him and Ballmer. That's a company with a lot of managers. So Google, on the other hand, has almost no managers. It's all engineers. I talked to somebody who said that the current headcount at Google, I don't know, I can't verify it, but that it's 70-1 engineers to managers. And it's not that the engineers are like playing cowboy and just doing whatever they want, and it's not that they're unaccountable, but there's an awful lot of flexibility in individual teams at Google to do what they want. It's almost like a federated company rather than a unified company with a cohesive mindset. And so, for example, the one area where they clearly compete directly against Apple is in mobile operating systems. And Google doesn't have one, they've got two. They've got Android and they've got Chrome OS. And they're completely unrelated. There's no similarity philosophically or technically between Android and Chrome OS. Whereas at Apple, they've got the iPad, which is clearly going to be competing in the market against netbooks running Chrome OS. And they've got the iPhone, which is already competing on mobile phones against Android. iPad and iPhone are clearly, philosophically and technically, siblings. It's a very different thing. But the real problem with thinking of Google as an arch rival for Apple is that they don't really care if Chrome OS and Android win. Like, Chrome OS and Android could turn out to be like, you know what, they never really worked out. And they're, Google, they're just fine with that, so long as the winner, if the winner is, say, the iPhone OS, and iPhone OS users are doing lots of Google searches and using lots of Google Maps and reading their email on Gmail, they still win. All they care about is people are using their services. And they just throw these other things up against the wall with the hope, well, maybe that'll help them use it more, and if they don't, so long as they're using them, they're happy. But if you flip it around and look at Apple's perspective, if Android and Chrome OS do really, really well, that's bad for Apple. So it's not really a direct competition. It's sort of indirect. The one company I see that I think really has a chance to turn into a true rival for Apple, at least in one area, is Palm. Their WebOS is really pretty great. And it kind of confuses me why it doesn't have more traction. But it doesn't. I think if it weren't for the iPhone, we'd all be going nuts for Palm's WebOS. And it's only because of the iPhone and that they came out later, and maybe it's a little bit slower, and they don't quite have the muscle that Apple has right now, that it doesn't seem to be going anywhere. But I'm convinced that it would be good for us, for sure, for Palm to do really, really well with WebOS in the long term, that it would be really, really good to have that sort of company that has the same sort of DNA as Apple in terms of focusing on great user experience and keeping things simple, and you know, they just kind of have the same vibe. They're the only company that is even vaguely on that same path. But I'd even go so far as to argue that it would be good for Apple as a company for Palm to do well but not too well, with WebOS, because I think it really does help keep a company focused when they have competitors, and that it's easy to lose your focus when your competitors simply disappear. One more. Number 10, about box credits. So all the way back to the origins of the Mac, there's always been a tradition that you launch an app, you go to the top left menu, used to be the Apple menu, now it's the application menu, and you pull it down, and the first item is about this app. And you select that item, and you get something like that. A little window pops up with information about the app, and copyright information, and something else. I don't know if you guys can see it. Can you tell which app that's for? It's for TextEdit. But it might as well be for any of Apple's apps, because they're all exactly the same. And they've been the same for like 10 years, and they're completely boring. And it used to be that your about box was a place where no matter what the app was for, it could be a word processor, it could be a spreadsheet, didn't matter. It could be like the most boring business app in the world. Your about box was a place where you could get creative. And it's, maybe like a loose analogy that your about box was sort of to software what a book cover is to a book. So Apple, they put all this creativity and branding work and emphasis into the application icon, and yet for some reason they've made this decision to put no effort at all into about boxes. And it used to be a thing where it was like a real source of fun. But there's another thing missing from this about box that used to be there, and that is the names of the people who made the product. That's the bigger and more depressing change from the old days. It used to be you'd go to about this app, and in addition to stuff like the name of the app and the version number, you'd get a list of all the people who made it. And this no credit for people, individual people in about boxes policy was instituted by Steve Jobs in the 90s, soon after he came back to the company. And the ostensible reason that he gave for it publicly was that he claimed headhunters were poaching Apple. Now you gotta remember, this is the height of the dot-com boom. So the whole Bay Area was filled with companies that were flush with cash. And Apple, of course, famously when Steve Jobs first returned, was struggling. And so Jobs said, he somehow got in his head that headhunters were stealing Apple employees from names and about boxes. Now, whether that's true in the first place, and I actually sort of doubt it. I don't doubt that Jobs believes it, but I actually kind of doubt that that's how they were doing it. I think it's simply the case that there were companies offering more money than Apple, and so they left. And I think there were a lot of people at the time at Apple who doubted Apple's prospects. So I don't think it's surprising at all, about boxes or not, that Apple was having retention problems, say, in 1997, 1998. But it doesn't matter if it was true, because it certainly isn't true now. Number one, Apple is not struggling. I don't see how anybody could argue that they are. In fact, they're now bragging about how much money they make. They can clearly offer to pay competitive salaries. And, it's just common sense. Good recruiters in the Bay Area do not need about box credits to figure out who's working at Apple. They know. There's no doubt that they know. So I compare this situation to another big collaborative creative endeavor, movie and TV shows. And movie and TV shows, when they end, they roll credits, and they roll credits with everybody who participated in them. Now, Hollywood has strict rules that have to be obeyed because they're enforced. They're part of the deals with all the unions, and everybody in Hollywood is in a union. And it's kind of spun out of control because now the movies, end in almost like 8 or 9 minutes of credits. And it's kind of funny, like when you rent like a movie from like the 60s or 70s and you watch it through the end, like just how short the credit sequences used to be. Like the guy who made the lunch sandwiches didn't used to get his name in the credits. But the fact that everyone who participates in a movie gets their name on it and for what they did doesn't seem to have hurt Steve Jobs' other company, Pixar, from retaining talent. And I think it can be argued very clearly that software can be art. And Apple has always been one of the leading practitioners of treating it as such. Artists should get to sign their work. Thank you very much. See you next year.
Two for the time. Come on, girls, let's rock that.